Welcome to Around the Empire, the show that takes you around the U.S. Empire. I'm your host, Dan Wright.
I'm your co-host, Joanne Leon.
And on today's show, May 2nd, 2017, we speak with Gareth Porter about how U.S. national security bureaucracies or the deep state sell out American interests of protecting us from terrorism to serve their own interests. Gareth Porter is an American historian, investigative journalist, and policy analyst specializing in the national security state. He's the author of several books, including Manufactured Crisis, The Untold Story of the Iran Nuclear Scare. His work has been published in distinguished media for decades, and he was the 2012 winner of the Martha Gellhorn Prize for Journalism. Here is that interview.
Welcome, Gareth. Thanks so much for doing this interview with us today. Appreciate it.
Hey, Gareth.
Thanks, Joanne. Good to be on with you and Dan. Thanks.
So we told Gareth that today we wanted to talk about an article that he published a little over a week ago in Middle East Eye. And the topic is how the deep state or the national security state has sold out American interests on counterterrorism for their own interests, and how extremist groups like Al-Qaeda are the ones who've benefited the most from that. And I was wondering if we could first, some of our listeners might not understand exactly how Al-Qaeda and ISIS came to be. So if you want to work that into the explanation, that'd be great too. And, you know, the ways that Al-Qaeda has benefited from this sellout. So how about if you just, you know, I'm going to turn it over to you and tell us the story.
Right. Well, I'll give you the really short version, hopefully. Essentially, the theme that I was developing in this piece, which really is something that I've been thinking about for quite a while, and you know, reading into the history of U.S. counterterrorism policy and how it relates to what has actually happened to Al-Qaeda. And of course, I think most people know that Al-Qaeda came out of the jihadist war in Afghanistan, which was sponsored by the United States with the help of Pakistan and Saudi Arabia. The Saudis and Pakistanis helping to essentially recruit jihadists from all over the Middle East and beyond to go to Afghanistan to fight the Russians and eventually force them to quit Afghanistan. And thus, in the end, of course, allow the Taliban government to take power, the Taliban being the sort of reformist group within the jihadist movement, not really jihadist in their outlook. But then eventually, Osama bin Laden, who had been one of the key organizers and facilitators of the training of jihadists in Afghanistan, decided, hey, I've got a good thing going here after the war was over, and there's more to be done by the Islamic jihad people. And so he then organized what was called Al-Qaeda and then became a terrorist organization which aimed at U.S. forces in Saudi Arabia, beginning with Saudi Arabia, and then moving to other U.S. targets outside Saudi Arabia, and of course, ultimately 9/11. So that was the origin of Al-Qaeda, but its fate was then really determined by the Bush administration and the Obama administration's Middle East, which was supposedly aimed at trying to crush Al-Qaeda, to defeat Al-Qaeda. That was the whole rationale for one use of military force after another after 2001. And in fact, what happened was that all of these policy initiatives by Bush and Obama was having the effect of building up and causing it to metastasize into other jihadist organizations throughout the Middle East. And of course, one of the products of that was the Islamic State, beginning as the Islamic State in Iraq, but then becoming ultimately Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, and ultimately Al-Qaeda in Syria, which of course we then knew as Al-Nusra Front. So the theme of my article is really how over the years since 2001, but particularly since 2003, U.S. policy has essentially used the so-called global war on terrorism, as declared by President Bush himself in 2001, as the cover I would say, for a whole series of military initiatives, which were really not being carried out at all for the purpose of stopping or reversing the progress of al-Qaeda, but were being carried out primarily because of the interests of the permanent war complex, primarily the Pentagon and the armed services, but also the CIA's covert arm, the operations directorate of the CIA, because those bureaucracies, which I think it's fair to call the most powerful bureaucracies humankind has ever known, have their own vested interest in seeing, you know, the United States embark on more and more initiatives, as long as they can handle the business, as long as they can fulfill the orders, as it were, expand their market, quote unquote. And that's exactly what I try to document in a very short article in Middle East Eye.
Right, right. Now, it seems like one of the things that happened with the war in Syria, as opaque and complex as it is, one of the things that happened was that it exposed the fact that we're on the same side as al-Qaeda, for one. And two, there are some elements of the national security state or deep state, whatever we call it, who favor, you know, indirectly using them as a ground force. You know, it just seems to me that I guess it's really proven that the fact that weapons that were sent for our quote-unquote moderate rebels ended up in the hands of al-Nusra, and the fact that al-Nusra and these rebel groups became, what do they call it, marbled, because al-Nusra was the strongest force on the ground, and the moderate rebel groups' programs that we tried to, you know, use as our proxies, just project after project failed on creating a strong ground force for the regime change operation. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that it wasn't very obvious until the Syrian war that we were actually, can you say that we're siding with al-Qaeda? I mean, I guess you can't. Whatever this complicated relationship is, it came to light with the Syrian war. And in fact, I think if the Syrian war hadn't dragged out as long as it did, it probably wouldn't have. And if Russia hadn't intervened, I'm not sure if it would have become this apparent, as clear as it is today.
Right about that, yeah. Yeah. And I would say, you know, it's a useful way of approaching this overall problem to distinguish between different stages during which or through which the policies of the Bush and Obama administration have passed with regard to the relationship between their uses of military force and al-Qaeda. I mean, I think it began with the thrust of the Bush administration being, we're going to conquer Iraq. We're going to use Iraq to remake the map of the Middle East. And we don't really care about al-Qaeda. And I think it's really accurate to say that about the Bush administration. It did not care about al-Qaeda. It simply did not take it seriously. These people, as I think it's well documented, had not followed the problem of al-Qaeda's development over the 1990s. They were not paying any attention. Their eyes were focused totally, their minds were focused totally on essentially defeating state adversaries of the United States and the U.S. military. That means, first of all, of course, Iraq, then Iran and Syria. Those are the big ones. Those are the ones they wanted to take down. And that's all they cared about. So it was primarily a matter of simply not caring about al-Qaeda during the Bush administration. And as al-Qaeda rose up and became more and more powerful, it started to dawn on them they had a problem, and then they had to cover it up in various ways, which I talk about in my article. There was the flypaper strategy. Some people may remember reading about the flypaper strategy, which was the brilliant creation of Paul Wolfowitz, the designer of the Iraq War. When it was clear that al-Qaeda was a force from all over, being drawn from all over the Middle East, jihadists converging on Iraq, Wolfowitz said, oh, good. Well, that means we'll kill them all in Iraq. And they got President Bush to actually say that publicly.
Oh, my God.
And so that was really that first or second stage of development. And then later on, you know, you get to the Obama administration, and they're carrying out a larger drone war in Pakistan and then in Yemen as well. And again, you have the phenomenon of, simply speaking, the bureaucracies that were controlling these drones, that is the CIA and the Air Force, and in Yemen, special operations had something to say about it. They were much more concerned with their own business, that is expanding the drone war, than they were about what was happening to Al-Qaeda, because it's important to them as bureaucracies. And the Obama administration, I would say, reluctantly was drawn along with this, partly because it was too embarrassing to admit that they'd made a huge mistake. Okay, politically, it didn't make sense for them. And then we get to Syria, and that is where you're absolutely right. You have a new stage where, you know, they began to realize as Al-Qaeda became not just the most important, not just the most single powerful military political force in opposition to the Assad regime, but it clearly exercised a degree of control over the non-jihadist armed groups opposing Assad. And it dawned on the brilliant strategists of the Obama administration, i.e., the people in the military, the Pentagon, and the CIA, particularly John Brennan, who graduated from becoming the counterterrorism chief of the administration, becoming director of CIA, that Al-Qaeda was actually potentially useful to the strategy that they were pursuing, which was to put pressure on Assad to step down. By the way, a strategy that a lot of people, even within the region, were extremely doubtful about. I mean, they didn't think it was going to work. But again, once you set foot on that path, it's very difficult for an administration to turn around and admit that they were wrong. So you continue on the status quo. And that is why, you know, basically the Obama administration did in fact embark on a strategy in support of the Saudis, the Qataris, and the Turks, who were the ones who were primarily saying, look, we need Al-Qaeda here to give enough of a push to Assad to force him to step down. And I think reluctantly, the Obama administration said, yeah, okay, we'll go along with that. And I think it was primarily, as far as the White House was concerned, they were being told that if we don't support the Saudis are going to create holy hell for us over the negotiations with Iran. And of course, they're going to cause problems for us with our access to the base in Bahrain, which they control. So basically, it was a matter of the Obama administration being afraid to cross the Saudis more than anything else.
I think this is the perfect time to bring up that, I mean, we're from New Jersey, and, you know, 9/11 hit hard around here. It's sort of unthinkable for most of the people I know anyway, that we could be allied with Al-Qaeda. I mean, that's just, it's a shocking, unthinkable thing. So, and I think you brought up John Brennan as a key figure here in the Syrian war. But what I wonder is, even though it is unthinkable, well, David Petraeus did say it, didn't he? He said, Nancy Youssef reported in September of 2015 that Petraeus was quietly trying to convince people in the Pentagon and the administration, even though he had, you know, left in a disgraced way, but he was trying to. The Daily Beast article said that Petraeus, quote, still wields considerable influence with current officials, U.S. lawmakers, and foreign leaders, and that he was trying to convince them that we should use Al-Qaeda in the Syrian war for because the moderate rebel thing was not working out very well. And it so happens that back in 2011, whose baby? Well, we know that the Syrian war is considered to be John Brennan's baby, I've read somewhere. But before that, was it Petraeus's? Whose idea was it to do Libya, to overthrow Gaddafi in Libya, and sort of attach that to create the rat line of weapons from Libya to the rebels in Syria? Like, who's it? Do we know who owned that?
Yeah, a certain would-be presidential candidate was really the primary political force within the administration behind that idea. She wasn't the only one, but Hillary Clinton was definitely the most powerful advocate within the administration of that option. And of course, she was being supported by various people within the administration who were of lesser stature, like Samantha Power and Susan Rice at that point. But in any case, definitely, as much as anyone, she was the primary advocate.
But then Brennan became the driver of the regime change part of this thing. And
I would say, you know, if you go back to the beginning of the Syrian war, in November, late 2011, again, you have a coalition here, which was essentially the centerpiece or the central characters in the coalition, pushing the idea of the United States getting on board with its Sunni allies in the Middle East, that is Turkey, Saudi, and Qatar. It was David Petraeus and Hillary Clinton. And in fact, Hillary talks about this, inviting David Petraeus over on a Saturday afternoon for lunch in 2012, when he was pushing the idea of resuming what had originally been a covert operation in November 2011. And the president was resisting this, but she was very, very much on board with Petraeus's idea, making, you know, a big move by the United States to support the opposition. So the two of them could be credited with the initiative of getting Obama to go along with a decision that I think he regretted to support the armed opposition, to actually provide the arms.
Right. And then Petraeus obviously remained interested, still vested in this project, even when he was out of the administration, because he was going around trying to say, hey, let's, you know, why don't we use al-Nusra? And when that was reported, he wrote a big official statement for CNN, which sort of denying it, but more like nuancing it.
Yeah. And the nuance, of course, it's very interesting and I think significant. The nuance was probably accurate, that what he was calling for was not supporting the official al-Nusra front, but rather supporting those within al-Nusra who were supposedly not really jihadist, you know, not global jihadists, but simply Islamists who were caught up in the excitement of fighting the Assad regime. Now, you know, of course, it's probably true there are some people within al-Nusra front who were not genuine jihadists, not terrorists, but the reality is perfectly clear that whoever those people are, they are subject to the discipline of an organization, effectively a party organization, a military organization, which is quite firm and which leaves them with no alternative but to go along with the war that they have chosen to fight. And so it was a silly idea, really. It was an idea by somebody advocating things that are, you know, in his own personal interests or pet projects that he feels like he can always somehow weasel out of the negative consequences of it.
Yeah, so that kind of talks about some of the interests that you bring up in your article, how keeping Americans safe from terrorism is just a front excuse. It's not their top priority.
I call it a bait and switch operation.
Right.
Meaning that the bait was to get the American people to go along with all of these wars, including the drone wars, the war in Syria, and all of the other things. The bait was that it's all part of the global war on terrorism. The reality was that that really had nothing to do with it. I mean, literally speaking, the people who designed these wars absolutely did not care about al-Qaeda. That was not the purpose of what they were doing at all. And, you know, it becomes clearer and clearer as time goes by in each case, if they did care about al-Qaeda, it would have stopped. The drone war in Pakistan would have stopped. The drone war in Yemen would have stopped because of the evidence that was so clear that those drone wars in both countries were building popular support for al-Qaeda, turning people against the United States, giving much more sympathy to the organizations that supposedly were being targeted.
But isn't that, to return to that theme, I mean, where now this is 6 years ago, Osama bin Laden was assassinated, I believe on this day, 6 years ago. But his strategy, speaking of bait, was essentially to, he may have had a willing partner, I would argue, with the Pentagon. The Pentagon wanted this too. The Cold War had ended. They had no justification for this spending anymore. There was no peer threat. They tried China, but Wall Street essentially waved them off and said, hey, we got too much business in here for this crap. So that spy plane went down. We don't care. Go away. So they needed a new source to justify a $600, $700 billion annual appropriation. And Islamic fundamentalism, the neocons were excited by it, you know, the sort of uniting theme. And bin Laden, one was bin Laden, you know, baited the Americans into coming in and so helping him. It's done better under this system than the al-Qaeda, which has risen, went from a marginal group that got chased out of every other country in the Middle East, including Tunisia and Algeria, everywhere else. They tried to have Islamic revolution, Egypt, which is, the, you know, sort of the foundational, you know, al-Zawahiri. And al-Zawahiri actually wrote his memoir because he thought he was going to be killed, called Knights Under the Prophet's Banner, and where he said, we blew it in Egypt. And then the Afghan Arabs go to Afghanistan and they help beat the Soviet Union. But then they're struggling. So they're struggling to regain past glory in Afghanistan. So they go back and they declare war on the United States. This is an organization with few people at all. It's kind of a joke. But then, in a sense, George W. Bush, you could argue, takes the bait and actually does start launching grand projects in the Middle East. What I would want you to, I guess, respond to is, is he happy that not happy that people are getting killed, but do they like this idea that, hey, here's this guy trying to bait us into coming in and overthrowing these regimes they tried to overthrow in the 80s and 90s. Now we're going to do it for him. So what do you think the perspective is from, I know the Pentagon wants to go in, but what about the political leaders? Were they fooled or were they happily fooled by bin Laden?
I'm not sure they were fooled at all. I think that there is plenty of evidence to support the contention that Osama bin Laden really did hope that the United States would respond to the 9/11 attacks by attacking Afghanistan, that would provide the impetus for the movement all over the Middle East to rise up to support al-Qaeda, and it would transform it into the Islamic resistance organization of the Middle East. So, and I think, you know, this has been the same thought behind al-Qaeda of Arabian Peninsula in Yemen. They clearly have the same thought. They would love to bait the United States into more and more intervention militarily in Yemen. It's worked wonderfully for them. I mean, the best thing that ever happened to them, of course, was the Saudi invasion and attack on Yemen, the horrible bombing of the Saudi coalition on Yemen, which cleared the way for them to move out of their existing area of control into a huge part of southern Yemen, more than one province, and giving them, that allows them to ally themselves with the other Sunnis who are fighting against the Houthis and to become legitimate for the first time in Yemeni history. Al-Qaeda of the Arabian Peninsula is now a legitimate political military force. When this war finally ends, they will be contenders for power. So you can imagine, you don't really have to exercise much imagination to understand that both the original al-Qaeda leadership and the leaders of the present al-Qaeda franchises in Iraq, in Syria, and in Yemen really, they must believe that these Americans are such rubes that they can manipulate them at will. And of course, they're right.
Right. So they are the fuel for, in my view, al-Qaeda, and comes from two places. One, U.S. intervention, which continually, you know, even when it's killing the right people, it pisses people off, but it often kills the wrong people. The right. Drone strikes have been completely off the chain. As we know with signature strikes, we know that basically they've been playing games with the numbers. If you're a young man, Muslim man of a certain age, in an area, you're considered a terrorist when they do the kill strikes. So they're killing innocent people all the time. And the other source of Al-Qaeda, which we refuse to deal with because they have so much political power in Washington, is the Saudis, who essentially pump out Al-Qaeda's ideology. There is no real fundamental difference between Wahhabism and the jihadist, Sunni jihadist ideology of Al-Qaeda or ISIS. In fact, a lot of people pointed out that Saudi Arabia beheaded more people than ISIS. And what is the real difference between Saudi Arabia and ISIS? So those seem to be the two fuels for Al-Qaeda, or do you disagree?
No, I don't disagree at all. I would just add a little footnote or an addendum to what you just said, which is it's not just the Saudis, although the Saudis, of course, are the big gorilla in the cage, but Qatar as well in Syria has been systematically, or at least was for a period now, maybe they've changed their policy, it's less clear now, but they were definitely supporting al-Nusra Front. In fact, they were supporting al-Nusra Front at a time when the Saudis were not. They were supporting other Islamist groups in Syria. So basically, the Qataris were the ones who were the leading edge of that policy. They did it earlier on. I think the Saudis went along with that in 2015 because that was the moment when both the Saudis and the Qataris and the Turks as well said, we have an opportunity now to really seize the initiative in this war for the first time and gain control of a very important key province, that is Idlib province in the north, abutting Turkey, and thus in a position to get supplies easily across the border from Turkey. And that will give us to really put pressure on Assad. And of course, from the point of view of the al-Nusra Front and their supporters, the real idea wasn't to force Assad to step down. They wanted to change the whole regime. They wanted to have a completely new Sunni regime. That was the whole idea, of course.
Right. And then Al-Qaeda becomes a kind of useful tool for Saudi Arabia, the Qataris, UAE, Turkey, and the jihadists generally do. But the problem is when it's a double-edged sword, you start playing with it. So we talked about on previous episodes how Turkey created the jihadi highway, how they had a very strong relationship with ISIS. They supplied them with arms. There was even a time when ISIS thought they were on their side. And then things started to turn, and now they're in a contentious state. ISIS did a New Year's bombing in Istanbul. So it seems like the reason Al-Qaeda and ISIS are kind of like a flare-up, like you have a bad joint and the weather's bad outside and it flares back up, is because they're so useful for these Gulf states. And then they get out of control and they have to put back, and then the U.S. goes in and clears it out a little bit. I mean, it just seems like there's no real interest in actually defeating these groups. The only interest seems to be in trying to rebrand them.
Isn't anybody worried about the rise of Al-Qaeda and the other extremist groups? I mean,
no.
I see a lot of cui bono, but...
No, they're not worried at all.
Even the former Israeli defense minister recently said, don't quote me on this, but basically we'd prefer...
No, the former ambassador to the United States, Michael Oren, or Daniel Oren, said, we want ISIS to win. We want the Sunnis to win the war because we're more afraid of Iran, and we don't want Hezbollah and Iran strengthened, which is, by the way, another problem, which you have a major ally, Israel, saying that they're essentially supporting Sunni jihadists aligned with Al-Qaeda.
I thought that Yalan said that they preferred one of the Sunni extremist groups in power rather than the Assad regime.
I think you're both right. I think they probably both said it. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, is anybody worried? That's a very good question. And I mean, I think the answer as far as the U.S. side is concerned is that I do worry at some level about that, but it's going to happen under somebody else's watch. They're not going to be responsible for it. And I'm not saying that this is the explicit thought in their mind, but it's the effect of the way they think and the way they operate hand down the road to worry about something like that, whereas they're gaining, you know, benefits from the policy as it's being carried out right now. I mean, that's the way government operates. That's the way bureaucracies operate. And that's the way presidents operate as well. So we're in a fix in terms of the interests of the American people because of the fact that the people have the power to make things happen, particularly these bureaucracies and the White House, insofar as they go along with these policies. Their interests are short-term interests that have to do with their own popularity, their own power, their own resources, and they just don't connect with the real interests of the American people. That's really the fundamental issue that I think we all need to really focus on, and we just haven't been doing that.
Right, right. I mean, the other thing that just, I know that it's true. I mean, I've seen enough examples of it, but do they really think they can convince Americans that we should be allied with Al-Qaeda? Or are they satisfied that the media will blur that up enough so that nobody will ever realize?
Well, first of all, they are clearly, they've been confident that the media would blur it so that it wouldn't be recognized. That much is clear. And on the first part of the question, I think, their thought process is not, they don't think of themselves as allying us with Al-Qaeda. They're simply taking advantage of the reality that happens to exist on the ground, which, you know, they're saying, well, we didn't create that. It just happened that way. We were trying, no, this is the way the official line goes. You know, we were trying to prevent Al-Qaeda and their followers from gaining power or being in a position to take power in Syria by arming the non-jihadist opposition, you know, the moderate opposition. Now, it didn't work out the way we hoped, but that's what we were trying to do. And the problem with that, of course, is that it became very clear so early on, by 2012, 2013, ambiguity about this. There was no real debate about this.
Obama admitted it. Obama said to Thomas Friedman in an interview, it's a complete fantasy.
Yeah, Obama admitted it. He knew perfectly well this was happening. So they can't really claim ignorance. They really have a very big monkey on their back on this, or at least they should in terms of the politics of the issue.
Well, are you surprised that now we're, God, I guess 16 years into the war on terror, and every time the U.S. screws up royally, all they have to do is this "we meant well" defense? Right. They have used this defense every screw up along the way, from Afghanistan to Iraq and all the negative repercussions, both of the civilians and terrorists coming back, the rise of ISIS, now in Syria, Libya, another one. Obama said it was his biggest mistake. He got elected to office running against Iraq, and he did Libya, which turned out to be a complete disaster. So, I mean, I just wonder. It seems like there's these old excuses, but they keep going, just like the 2001 authorization for the use of military force is still being used. We're 16 years in, and we still have a 2001 authorization. I'm just wondering, at some point, doesn't the "we meant well" defense run a course and so negative that your intentions no longer matter?
Well, in a functioning democracy, it wouldn't work, that's clear. But they do have ways of making this work, obviously. And you know, the ultimate point here, I think, is that they have to do this. I mean, this is a matter of survival for the what I call the permanent war complex. They have to make those arguments. They have to say, this is what we were really trying to do, and to say, you know, it's too early to say what the consequences are going to be. In other words, to simply fuzz over the reality, because if they told the truth, it would be all over for the permanent war complex. I mean, they would.
You mean if they said we need to be at war with somebody or we can't justify this budget?
Right, exactly.
Yeah, I don't think they're saying that.
By themselves, and the only way to do that is to create this alternative reality.
Speaking of the AUMF, I mean, the AUMF authorizes us to fight Al-Qaeda, right? So that's a really big problem in Syria, having our troops in Syria, where we're actually, let's just say, aligned. If we don't say allied, say aligned with Al-Qaeda, and using that AUMF as our reason, you know, as our legal justification to be there. It just, other people have said this, just, it's stunning. It's just really stunning to me. I don't know why I continue to get surprised, but.
It's something that should be raised, that's for sure, yeah.
I had one more quick thing I wanted to ask you, sort of, how this all started, or basically whose pet project this is. That subject interests me, with Brennan, Petraeus, and Hillary and all that. Well, then McMaster came on the scene, and I've read that McMaster has worked with Petraeus or is influenced by him. And since you are both both wrote books on Vietnam. I wondered, what are you thinking about McMaster?
McMaster is a bright, capable, up-and-coming three-star general now during the Iraq and Afghanistan wars. He was graduating from lieutenant colonel to one-star general. So he's made his way up the ranks very rapidly. He's very good at finding powerful sort of sponsors to help him up the ladder. And of course, Petraeus was one of those people, for sure. No question about that. That's why he's associated with him. One important thing to know about McMaster is that during the Vietnam War and after the Vietnam War, he was one of those people who was making an argument that the military should have been more insistent on its position that we can't win this war without using the air power in a much less restrained way, which was what, of course, the Joint Chiefs of Staff were arguing during the LBJ administration. LBJ was keeping the wraps on, relatively speaking, would not allow them to carry out the worst kind of strategic bombing, although it was horrible, it was terrible, believe me, and particularly in South Vietnam. But the Joint Chiefs were upset that they weren't unleashed to do much more. And what McMaster wrote in his book on Vietnam was that the Joint Chiefs were fundamentally in error by not telling the president that if he didn't go along with their demands for the use of air power, they would quit en masse, force the hand of LBJ, and perhaps he was right, who knows. But it was basically saying, use all of the potential political power that you have available to force the hand of the president to do far more with air power to win this war. So I would describe him as a very hawkish, calculating, and ambitious officer who can be very, very dangerous.
Yeah, but that was, I mean, I guess maybe his nuance of that can be say, well, if they had done it earlier, that might have made a difference. Because when Nixon came in, the standing order that was eventually given out by Kissinger was anything that flies against anything that moves. Now, that is total war, if ever a phrase encapsulated total war. So the idea that the military couldn't win because they were restrained, I mean, maybe it was true in the LBJ case. I doubt it. But I mean, Bob McNamara was essentially running the show. Now, maybe they disagree with Bob McNamara's quantitative approach, body count, all that. But when Nixon got in, they got the gloves came off. They even bombed illegally, right?
It did come off in the sense that he applied it much more intensively in specific places at specific times. Yes. And of course, at the end of the war, there was the Christmas bombing and so forth, which was the most outrageous in some ways. But nevertheless, it was too late by that time.
I mean,
by the time they were doing it, too late. So I think he was really talking about the LBJ period, essentially. His book is about the LBJ period and is aimed at that specific set of choices that was presented there. And I think basically, you know, it was a useful book in some ways. It had some interesting information in it. In fact, you know, there was one footnote that I draw from his book in my own book on Vietnam. Unfortunately, he'd made a mistake and he'd cited the wrong information. And I pointed that out to him and he said, oh, well, sorry about that. And I'll try to find it in my files, but they're all packed away somewhere. And he never did find it. So I had to go to press without being able to resolve the issue.
You know a little bit about McMaster real quick. What do you think the dynamic between him and Flynn? Because Flynn was targeted clearly by people within the deep state. I don't, for the exact reasons we don't know why, me and Joanne have both publicly said we think John Brennan targeted Flynn with the leak, the unmasking the leak. No evidence for that. That's a criminal charge if it happens. Who knows? But Flynn, when he was head of the Defense Intelligence Agency, wrote this embarrassing memo that came out. We know John Brennan and Flynn hated each other. What's McMaster's relationship with Flynn?
Well, I mean, McMaster did not join the administration until Flynn was out, of course. So
right.
To the degree that he had any role at all, it was very indirect. I would say that McMaster is smarter than Flynn by far. I mean, Flynn is a weirdo. I mean, he's got a couple of screws missing, to say the least. But I think, no, I think that Brennan would be a logical candidate to look at. But Flynn had other enemies as well within the White House. So it wouldn't have been just Brennan. I mean, definitely Brennan was, remember, Brennan was out by that time. He was gone from CIA.
Right. And so, could have been his Murder on the Orient Express thing where everybody.
I think it's much more people within the White House who were contending for power. You know, there was a huge fight going on constantly in the first weeks of the administration. And I think it's those people who were the primary ones who, basically got Trump to fire Flynn because he was too much trouble for the president. He was under too much pressure, and this was the best way. I think they probably convinced him that, you know, he simply couldn't fight this fight. He had to give somebody up, and it was Flynn's turn to be the sacrificial lamb at this point.
Right.
Well, he was gonna mess with the intelligence community too. So I mean, that was unthinkable. But I guess that's the Brennan thing. But
yeah. But Flynn was, I think, mainly targeted because he was such a lucrative target. I mean, he was clearly that it was most easy to get to on the part of the foes of the Trump administration. And they're right that Flynn, getting rid of Flynn was the best thing that Trump could have done politically to try to ease the pressure on himself.
I wonder if McMaster has a similar opinion of the war against ISIS. Unleash the generals and ramp up the air power and, you know, be curious to see if he...
Well, that's what's happening, right, in Mosul?
It is. It is.
Well, yeah. And of course, here again, you run into an interesting phenomenon of two sets of, or not two sets of interests, but two contradictory interests within the military, one of which is to, you know, have a successful operation, which means that they have to be able to present results that are going beyond how many people you kill. I mean, they know that's not going to work to say we've killed X number or X thousand of ISIS fighters. And secondly, they want to have, you know, as much of the business as possible in the sense of an expanding war against ISIS. I mean, to expand the war is always good unless there's a very powerful reason to not do so. To show effectiveness on one hand and to have an expanding war against ISIS have really been in tension for some time. And you can see why, because, you know, the more they bomb, the more civilians they're going to kill, and the more they're subject to questioning about the effectiveness of it. But at the same time, when they were trying to limit the bombing, then people were questioning whether this was going to work at all. And they knew that they weren't getting as much mileage or as much business as they could get out of the war against ISIS.
Now, this is interesting. So let's say they defeat ISIS, which is possible, right? Let's say it actually ends. Maybe it'll call itself something else after it flares back up. But there were a lot of countries on the hit list, and the one that seems to be left relatively unscathed that was a focus for Flynn and other neoconservatives or whatever is Iran. Now, Iran is a major state actor. There's generals and commanders who probably have a personal gripe with Iran because Iran was definitely facilitating the killing of U.S. soldiers during the Iraq occupation. But on the other hand, that's a lot to bite off to chew. Do they really want a military conflict with Iran? I mean, they could start one. They could start bombing Hezbollah, which Israel is already doing, by the way. Israel is launching strikes against Hezbollah in Syria. I mean, there's ample opportunity, but I wonder if even the Pentagon wants a full-on tangle with Iran.
Well, that's a question that I've been following very closely over the years since the Bush administration, and I think the answer is very simple. They do not. The Pentagon is quite strongly against a move that would risk very seriously entangling the United States military in a war with Iran. And again, the reasoning is very straightforward, and it's primarily the commanders in the field who would be the most strongly opposed to it because they have the most to lose. The Navy, because they have very expensive warships, including the aircraft carrier fleet, the aircraft carriers and their supporting vessels, which would be sitting targets, sitting ducks in a fight with the Iranians. And then, of course, if there's a war that's initiated by Israel or the United States, we're going to include the U.S. bases in Qatar and in Bahrain. It's as simple as that. They can reach them very easily now.
I'd actually like to do an interview just on that topic. It's such a fascinating topic. If we could convince you to come back, Dan's laughing because I'm always saying that whenever we have a guest, like, we want to talk to you again. I mean, you're really an expert on this subject. That Manufactured Crisis book is on my list now. I've heard Scott mention it many times, but I definitely need to read that book.
I'm afraid the subject is going to be with us for a long time into the future, and there are going to be some things in the book that'll be relevant, I'm quite sure.
But it seems like similar with Russia. We want Russia to do the things we want them to do. We want to push them around, basically. But we really don't want to get in a war with them. And I think the same is true with Iran.
Yeah, absolutely. It's the same principle applies for sure, yeah.
But there are some people that are pretty scary on this. The MEK lobbyists like Giuliani and...
Our former senator, Robert Torricelli, was an MEK lobbyist.
God. That guy's such trouble. They're talking about regime change in Iran, and they sound pretty serious. Maybe it's a proxy war they want. I mean, I guess we already have, you could argue we already have that.
Those people are getting paid off, so I don't think they're particularly concerned with whether the policy gets carried out. I mean, my guess is that they're vaguely in favor of it, but hey, cross my palm with $35,000 per speech, and yeah, I think I could go along with that.
All right, well, I hope that's the case, that they're not invested. It's the ones who are ideologically invested that you worry about.
The right upside now. Of corruption. They're just shaking down these MEK people for money. That's the upside.
Right.
If you like, Gareth, tell us about any of your work. If you want to talk about your book.
Well, thank you. I would like to just mention the fact that I'm working on a new book, just starting. I finished the book proposal, and I'm in the process of trying to get it published. But I've got it very well worked out. And it's a book about what we've been talking about, only the larger picture, the way in which the what I call the permanent war complex, and that's basically what the military-industrial complex has morphed into since 2001, since the 9/11 attacks, how the permanent war complex and its predecessor have functioned, an inside sort of anatomy and explanation of the way in which it really operates to essentially promote its own institutional interests. That is the institutional interests of each of its parts, the civilian bureaucracy in the Pentagon, led by the Secretary of Defense, the armed services of the Joint Chiefs of Staff and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, and then the CIA, particularly the operations branch, whether the operations arm of it, which are the most powerful part of the CIA, and the National Security Agency, which is now really an important part of the war complex, and how those organizations have lobbied for, pushed for, pressured for, over and over again since 2001, uses of force that we've seen with a couple of exceptions. With a couple of exceptions, and the Libya war is one that they opposed. The Libyan war clearly was not one that the Joint Chiefs of Staff wanted or that the civilian leadership in the Department of Defense wanted. This was coming from the White House itself and from, you know, Samantha Power and so forth. This was the humanitarian intervention that the military simply didn't think was of interest to them. And they, of course, were on the right side on that. But otherwise, not just since 2001, but since Vietnam. And Vietnam began a whole new series of wars, which then it led to the war in the first Gulf War in Kuwait in 1991, and then to the Kosovo War, the Balkans War, and then series of wars that have come after 9/11 attacks. And in each case, I can document, and I will document in my book, how the war complex lobbied for, put pressure on the White House to carry out the use of force in their own interests. And each case, they had very specific interests in mind, the reason that they were pushing for these wars. And I explain all that in my book.
Well, I'll look forward to reading that. I think the big picture, if we have any hope of real foreign policy change, then more Americans need to understand that. They need to really stop this. We need to burst this bubble, this myth about good guys and bad guys and all of that.
We need to create a new narrative which talks about the real bad guys, the bad guys who have been really betraying the interests of the American people for decades, and now betraying them in a much more direct and really horrible form that is about terrorism, which is a direct threat to the United States.
Now, where can people find your work, Gareth?
Well, I write for various publications, but primarily Middle East Eye, a London-based news source on the web. And Truth Out is one that I've written for frequently. And more frequently, I've been writing for Bob Perry's Consortium News. So those are the big three. And occasionally, I get into others as well.
Great. All right. Thanks so much, Gareth. Really appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Good to talk
to
you both.
See you later.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
And that's our show. I want to thank you for listening, and a special thank you to Gareth Porter. Find his work at Middle East Eye, Truth Out, and Consortium News. Gareth's recent article, U.S. Deep State Sold Out Counterterrorism to Keep Itself in Business, is featured in the Middle East Eye. If you'd like to support the show, you can do so for $5 a month at patreon.com/aroundtheempire. We deeply appreciate it. Follow Around the Empire on Twitter, @AroundTheEmpire. Questions, comments, want to yell at me? Dan@shatterproof.com. See you next time.
Take care.
Thank you.